because the church needs it, your money, but because God has commanded that in his word, to give up your tithes and offerings. And just remember that this morning, that the offering containers are located at both exits. And I know that God's going to bless us as we continue to be obedient to his word. Because the word of God says, give and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together, to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount to give back. That's in the New Living Translation, but you know, if you go back to the basics of in King James or New King James, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, that you cannot contain it. Amen. That's what your obedience to the Word of God is going to do. And we don't give so that we receive. We give out of that obedient heart to the Father God, because he's done so much for us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Did you come ready to worship the Lord this morning? Let's all stand. Father, we just thank you this morning that we have the privilege of being worshipers of the Most High, of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Father, we are privileged and honored to be in your house this morning. Privileged and honored to be able to worship you in this place, Father, to lift you up above everything that we have going on in lives today, Father. To focus our attention solely on you, Father. And we will posture our hearts, Father, centering our hearts on you this morning, God. And we give you all the praise and the honor and the glory. You are in our lives. In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen. Hallelujah.
Jesus,
You don't change. We're glad that goodness is a dimension of who you are. Father, we just take a moment to thank you personally, God, for maybe all those places, Holy Spirit, that you would bring to mind now to each person in this room. The accident, the divorce, an abusive situation, the loss of life, the death of a loved one, the loss of a child. And all those instances, you were there and you were good. Jesus, we thank you for that. Father, we thank you that you are good. Lord, we thank you that you're here with us this morning. Holy Spirit, we recognize your presence in the building. We yield and we surrender to you right now. We ask in these next moments that you would speak to us, Lord. That you would open the heavens and give us your voice. Would you amplify it in every heart? And would you speak to our situations and circumstances? God, give us hope and empower us with truth this morning. Jesus, be the master teacher at every seat. Jesus, be the guide that lights our way. Lord Jesus, I ask that you would take what we have and that you would multiply it as you did with fishes and loaves. God, would you multiply your word in this space today? That many would be satisfied because of you. Jesus, we love you and we thank you. Holy Spirit, we yield completely and totally to you. In Jesus' name. Good morning, Grandview.
Good morning.
I'm so blessed to be here again with you this Sunday morning. I honor the Lord for his strength and his grace. I honor your pastor in his absence. I love the man and his family, all the elders and the leaders of this church. Bless you. I'm so happy this morning that my wife, Natasha, made the trip with me. She's here in the front row. The impotent man answered him, "Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to me." while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed, and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. Verse 10. The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, It is the Sabbath day, it is not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. He answered them, He that made me whole, the same said to me, Take up thy bed and walk. Then asked they him, What man is that which said unto me, Take up thy bed and walk? And he that was healed was not who it was, for Jesus had made himself a way, a multitude being in that place. Verse 14. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple, and said unto him, Behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon thee. The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him whole. Can you say amen this morning to the reading of God's word? This is such a phenomenal passage of scripture. And if I'm completely honest, it's something that actually came into my life most recently out of the context of a healing. The Lord began to take me on this journey to heal some hurts and some pains. And I was in a meeting, and the gentleman leading the meeting took us to this passage and just zeroed in on verse number 6 and asked that question, Do you want to be made well? We'll talk about that here in a second. But this morning I'm focusing on Jesus, and I've actually entitled this message, Jesus, Healing and Power. We need both. And Jesus is the source for our healing and for our power. Amen. And, you know, there's so many details here that we don't have the time to go through them all. But I just want to draw your attention, and we'll go through several verses here. At the very outset of this chapter, John is taking the time to give details of the scenario, which his immediate readers would have understood, but sometimes we miss all these things, that there is this location in Jerusalem near a gate. Now, that Jerusalem was a large city at the time that Jesus lived, and they had different gates for different things. There were gates, you know, probably a main gate that important people would come through, and that was probably well kept and nice, and they had other gates for other reasons. There was a refuse gate, so that's where all the trash went out. The city. That's probably not a gate that you wanted to use unless you absolutely had to in an emergency. And they reference this place, and they call it the sheep market, or it's near the sheep gate. And so the selling of livestock, of these sheep, this livestock, was probably something that was very important. But if you've ever worked in agriculture or with animals, you know that they are messy. Okay? They don't hold it until they can get to a convenient place to let it go. So, this sheep market, or this pool near the sheep market, indicates to us that this was probably not the most sanitary or comfortable place to be. It smelled bad, okay? It probably looked bad, and it felt bad. And if you can imagine having a pool that was nearby, if this was a sheep market, then it was more than likely possible that the shepherds or those herding these animals probably took their sheep at time to this pool. So I don't know how many of y'all are, you know, consider yourself country folk that just enjoy, you know, jumping in a pond or in a lake and just having a good old time. I'm from Chicago, we didn't do that. Okay, you went to the YMCA where you had your nice pool with lots of chlorine in it, that's where you went. You didn't go to the sheep pool or maybe to the pond that the cows also go and drink in, okay? Or the cows go and play in and cool off in. You know, sometimes that's people swimming pools. So we have a lot that's happening with this location that simply indicates to us it probably was not a very, very nice place. But here are, in verse number 3, a great multitude of impotent, the Bible says, impotent simply means that these individuals were powerless in some respect to change their physical situation or circumstance. They were legitimately impotent. It describes these impotent people as being blind. They could not see some of them. They were halt. The definition of halt actually means that maybe they were footless or somehow limited in their mobility. certain season, an angel, listen to this, it almost sounds like a movie, like, is this really real? An angel would come down from heaven, strike the Mississippi, and if you were in the water, as muddy as it might be, those waves from the strike, if they had hit you, whatever sickness and disease that you had, you could be healed from that. Wouldn't that be amazing? Wouldn't it be what I decided to call almost magical? That this supernatural event could happen and bring transformation to your life. Sometimes, I'm going to talk about me. If you fit in the boat, just jump right in it. Sometimes I have found myself waiting for a magical moment. I've wanted something supernatural to happen, to come and to resolve that impotency in my life. Maybe I have been halt. Maybe I've been withered. Maybe I've been stuck or limited in my growth, in my faith, in my life. Maybe there's been something that I've had a long time, and I've just gotten lost in this crowd of impotent people. Though I'm saved and though I go to church, I come and I'm waiting for something magical to happen. Come on, I've done it like this. I've been in a service and we've had a guest speaker and an evangelist and someone that's anointed and full of God's power and can tell me everything that's happening awesome in their life. And I just can't wait to get in the prayer line. I believe in prayer. We should have faith in God. I can just wait to get in the prayer line because maybe, just maybe, something magical would happen when they pray for me. Everything would be changed. I've waited. Maybe, just maybe, if I heard the right sermon and the right messenger, or maybe just maybe if it was the right worship moment, the angel would come down and stir all of us, and we would be transformed and changed. And all that we've been longing for and waiting for as a multitude of impotent folk, it could be healed and changed in a magical moment. This group of people, particularly for this man here in this passage, it didn't happen like that. It hasn't always. In fact, it hasn't happened like that for me. But what I've discovered in reading this chapter, what the Holy Spirit is helping to see, is don't wait and look for the magical moment. Look for Jesus. Come on, because the angel never showed up to make a difference in the man's life. But Jesus did. And when, listen, this is what I love about Jesus. When Jesus came, he paid attention to this man. It says there was a multitude of people that were there. And somehow Jesus was keyed in, zeroed in on this man's life. There's a song that's out there in the gospel music world right now that says, he knows my name. You know my name. Can I say that to you this morning? The Lord knows your name. He knows your address, your situation, your circumstance. He understands every single thing that's happening in your life right now. And you don't need to wait and hope and cross your fingers and pray that your guardian angel is going to get it together to come to your rescue, because there is a Savior who has come to rescue us. His name is Jesus. So, verse number 5, the Bible says, a certain man was there. Again, giving him distinction, a specific recognition of who he is. We don't know his name, but Jesus knew his situation. And it says, this man that was there, he had an infirmity. 30 and 8 years. Let's talk about infirmity for just a second. He had infirmity for 30 and 8 years. Maybe he had been diagnosed as a child with this infirmity. Maybe there was something that had happened in his life that caused him to have this infirmity. We don't know. We just know that he had it for 30 and 8 years. This passage jumps out to me personally because I'm actually 38 years old. And as I begin to read through this, and I was sharing with my wife a few weeks ago, I began to read and to look at this. I said, I'm 38 years old, and I yet feel like there's things in my life that I've been trying. There's things that God has been in pursuit of my entire life. And so these infirmities can sometimes challenge us. This word infirmity, it actually means a want of strength, a lack of strength, weakness. If there is a weakness, I don't know if any of you are at a humble place enough to say, maybe just say it real softly, but I got some weaknesses. I'm not Superman. Okay. I don't know. Maybe let's just branch out and try and testify to your neighbor to the left or right and just tell me who whispers and say, I'm not Superman. Come on now. Ladies, you can make it personal. I'm not Superwoman. Come on. I got some weaknesses. I cannot handle everything. In regards to the body infirmity, it means that this body is weak or frail, that there's a feebleness of health, or maybe even a sickness that has invaded the body and now causes it to be less than what it should be or was designed to be. Kind of weakness. Don't know how to handle this. I'm infirmed. It might be a temporary infirmity. It may be what the doctors sometimes describe as a permanent infirmity. You'll have to live with this the rest of your life, they say sometimes. Some unfortunate situations, they even declare this is terminal. Eventually, this thing will cure. Infirmity also is an application of the soul. In the Greek, this word it means, with regard to the soul, a lack of strength or capacity in the soul to understand anything. It's a lack of strength or capacity to do great things, to do glorious things. On my own, I cannot do it. And of the soul, it means a lack of strength to restrain corrupt desires. Come on, church folk. Sometimes we have a lack of strength to restrain corrupt desires. Where did that go? Person cut me off in traffic, and now I'm thinking I could just ram my car into the back of them and send them flipping over. Oh, where did that come from, Lord? This lack of restraint of a corrupt desire for revenge. Of the soul, it also means a lack of strength or capacity to bear trials and troubles. Well, come on, we have trials and troubles, but we don't always bear them with joy. We don't always walk through those things graciously and with the power and the anointing of God. These are what the Bible describes as infirmities, everyone. But I'm glad this morning that it says in Hebrews 4 and 15 that we do not have a high priest who cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. It says in the New Living Translation, that same verse, this high priest of ours understands with our infirmities or weaknesses. Jesus knows and understands. He gets it, everyone. He understands. He sees it. He sees the place of weakness. He doesn't stand there as a condemning judge and say, you should be stronger. He says, all you that are weak and heavy laden, come to me. Because I have a place of rest for you. Come to me. Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case. Jesus looked at the man's life and he knew it, he understood it, he got why he was there. Jesus says to him, will you be made whole? Other translations say, Jesus says, do you want to be made whole? Come on, that's the question the Lord is asking us. Do you want to be made well? When they asked me that question a few weeks ago, do you want to be made well? I have to be honest. Sometimes, I'm going to get in trouble with my wife here. Sometimes, just on occasion. And so, the smart aleck me would reply to Jesus asking me this question. What do you mean do I want to be made well? Have you not heard the prayers? Have you not seen the tears? Why do you think I'm still going to church? Why am I doing all these things? What, Jesus, why was this man at a nasty, smelly pool near to where they sold sheep? Why was he there waiting for this magical moment? Don't you see? He wanted to be made well. Then the Holy Spirit often comes, and he checks me. Sometimes he has the voice of Natasha. Somebody said this right. Amen. Okay. He'll come in and just say, listen, be good. Close your mouth and be quiet and listen again to the question. Because he's not asking you to give him a whole bunch of reasons why you shouldn't ask that question. He's asking you that question so you can submit to it and connect to him in faith with a very simple answer of, yes. Come on, everybody practice that. Say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, I want to be made well. Yes, Lord, I want to be made well. Seeing and knowing that Jesus, you understand everything about my situation, and you know that I lie where I have lain for a long time. That some of these challenges have been linked to me for decades at a time. You see all of these things, Jesus. Yes, I still want to be made well. And as you know, I begin to tell the Lord, I say, God, yes, I still want to be made well. God, yes, 1,000 times, yes. And even if this didn't work or that didn't work or if I missed this chance or that opportunity, God, yes, I still want to be made well. My yes, Lord, make it an eternal yes to you that yes, I want to be made well. Yes, begin to find strength and answer the Lord's question with a yes. Now, watch this carefully. Verse 7. A lot of preachers have done this to this man. I'm trying not to do this to him today. But the man asked Jesus, sir, I have no man when the water troubled to put me into the pool. While I'm coming, someone else beats me to it. They get down in the water before me. I've heard this passage preach where we then kind of lampblast this certain man and say, he just offered a whole bunch of excuses. I heard one person say, surely, at 38 years, he could have crawled to the edge of the pool. I'm not doing that to him this morning, because I don't see Jesus doing that to him. Jesus was waiting for a yes. Can I say this to you? That even when we answer the wrong way, even when we come with what might be legitimate excuses or illegitimate excuses, Jesus is still patient, and he's listening, and he's waiting for a yes. Even the faintest of yeses is what he's after. So this man says to him, I don't have a man. And Jesus says, listen, I'm here. I'm here right now. I'm talking to you. I'm the man of all men. I am the Son of Man. You don't need another man if you have me right here to put you in the water. He says, I don't have a man when the water is troubled. Jesus says, stop worrying about the troubled water. I am the living water. Amen. I have the answer. You don't have to wait on an angel because I created the angels. The man says, I don't have a man and when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. And while I'm coming, someone else needs me. They get that lesson before I do. And Jesus says, what I have for you is just for you. The blessing reserved for your life, it is reserved for your life. It's God's desire. No one else is going to beat you out of what God has for you. Your journey may look different. Your path may look different. The things that he takes you to through certainly may not be what everyone else goes through. But what he has for you, it is just for you. You need to know we serve that type of God. He loves us. What he's created and designed for our lives, no one can take it away from us. So Jesus is listening for the faintest of yes in this man's answer. And I believe the Lord heard it. Because if you look at verse number 8, Jesus, they don't have a long dialogue. But Jesus hears the man's response and he says, okay, I hear the whisper. what you just did to me. So I'm going to do it for you. He says to him in verse 8, rise, take up your bed, and walk. And when I read this, I'm going to be honest, when I read it, in the first read, the first little season I'm going through this, I said, Lord, God, help me to understand this, because apparently I don't understand you. And he reminded me, and I said, your thoughts are not like my thoughts. Your ways are not like my ways. As high as the heaven is above the earth, so are my ways. Okay, God, I get it. I'm down here, you up there. So just help me a little bit, Lord. Why in the world would you tell this man to do stuff that he never had done before? The Lord just began to speak to my heart, because when I do that, it means I want to empower you to do it. I'm not, listen, there's some stuff God is not waiting on you to be strong enough to do. He's calling you now. And as you respond to him in faith, he gives you power to do what he's called you to do. So he says to me, the infirm man, this impotent man, he says, rise. Stand up right where you are. Well, I haven't gotten in trouble. Woman, I can ask you nothing about trouble, water, or magical moments. Stand right where you are. Take up your bed. You've been resting in this place of expectation for too long. And I'm here now. Stand and take up your bed. I call you to stay in this place of apathy any longer. Not calling you to stay in this place of hopelessness any longer. Can you imagine how hopeless and demoralizing it was that this man had been there a long time and someone always beats him? He feels like, I don't have a portion. It's never going to happen for me. I'm just left out. God, do you even see me? God, are you even aware? Do you even love or care about me? Jesus says, no, pack up this bed and get out of this place. And he tells him the last directive there. Verse 8, walk, which means move forward from this moment. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians that he empowers us to walk in newness of life. It means put one foot in front of the other and trust him for every single step. Rise and take up your bed and walk. Walk out of it. Walk through it. Walk beyond it. Take up your bed and walk. And then the interesting thing, verse 9, it says, and immediately the man was made whole. Come on, that's the miracle, guys. That's the moment of a miracle. Immediately this man was made whole. Can I tell you, I have discovered this beautiful truth and balance about God. He has the power, and yet does it today, where he will come in an instant and work a miracle. He'll do it just like that. I tell you, the day I got saved, I was high as a kite. I was addicted to drugs. I somehow, by God's grace, I prayed the sinner's prayer. And when I said, in Jesus' name, amen, the power of God hit me like a sledgehammer. And in a moment, I was delivered. You all remember that moment right there where you all clapped? Okay, I want you to do this again in a second. In a moment, took the taste for crack cocaine right out of my mouth. Instantly, I was shocked and amazed. I was like, oh my goodness, I think I just got saved. In a moment, he did that. This is the balance. He comes and he works miracles in a moment. But then, he leads us by his spirit, hopefully, for a lifetime. We have to walk out of that moment the miracle of his grace. You can clap right there. This is why I ask you to clap right there, because I don't really want to applaud that. Wait, you mean I still got to live life after this miracle? Yes, ma'am, you do. Wait, you just worked a miracle in my heart, and my life transformed and changed me? You delivered me from these vices and sins? But now I still have to walk out every day in my marriage as a loving person. Every day, Lord, you still want me to live by your grace with the reality of that moment in my heart. The answer is yes. Come on, look at your neighbor and just do like I'm doing. Tell him yes. But at some point, we got to come down from the mountaintop, and he expects us to walk this thing out in the valleys and on the slopes. Immediately, the man was made whole. He took up his bed and walked, and on the same day was the Sabbath. And in the next four verses, we immediately see him having to live out of that moment. Because the first thing he encounters is a challenge. And ironically, shockingly, this challenge comes from the religious order of the day. They say to him in verse 10, "It's not lawful for you to carry your bed." You can't do what Jesus just told you to do. You're moving beyond a place of limitation, a place of stunted expectations, hoping and waiting for the wrong thing. You're doing what Jesus just told you to do. You cannot do that. That's not according to the law. They completely misunderstood what this man was doing. It had nothing to do with keeping a bunch of rules and regulations. It was the liberty that Jesus Christ brought to his life. But they said, "No, you can't do that." He enters into this dialogue with them, and they say, "Well, who told you you could do that?" He says, "Actually, I don't even know the man's name. I just know his heart and his power. He told me to do it, and I'm whole and I can do it." Verse 14, it says, "Afterward, Jesus finded him in the temple." I love this because it shows us that Jesus is always coming back around. He cyclically wants to enter our lives and give us revelation by his Spirit. Listen, he intends to be a part of your life and my life for eternity. And we have these wonderful opportunities to learn from him continuously, consistently. He comes back around. You know, in the Gospels, how it describes Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. This was a family in Bethany, real close to Jerusalem. And we read several places in the scripture where Jesus keeps showing up at their house. He comes for a meal. He leaves. He comes back for another. He leaves. He keeps coming back into these people's lives. Because why? He's there. He's imparting truth. They live out of that truth. He comes back. He imparts more truth. They live out of that truth. He comes back. In some instances, Mary, she caught on and she just began to sit at Jesus' feet when he was there. The dishes can wait, serving all his food can wait, his mouth is open, I'm sitting at his feet and I'm listening. So then when tragedy strikes, we know who to call. Lazarus is sick, who do we call? We call Jesus. Why? Because he's been in and out of, he's consistently cycling through our lives. And even when he showed up with what they thought was too late, he still was right on time. So this man finds, or Jesus finds this man in the temple, and he says to him, listen, he says, "Behold, you are made whole. Sin no more. Behold, you are made whole. Sin no more." Why does Jesus say this? Why does he? I believe the Lord came to reiterate the truth to him because the enemy just tried to steal it from him from these religious attacks. And what I want to say to everyone this morning is do not believe the lie of the devil. You know, the enemy, my grandmother used to always say, he couldn't tell the truth if he tried. It says that he is a liar. He was a liar from the beginning. The very words that he said to Eve relates with deception and lies. He will lie to you all day long about God's plans, desire, and work in your life. Do not believe him. You have been made whole. Amen. Come on, you have been made whole. Look at your neighbor and echo the truth of the Spirit. Tell them, you have been made whole. Come on, you have. But at the end of the day, it is sin. And God is not confused about it. And although we have sin in this world, sin within the populace, sin is also a personal problem. So lest I just point fingers at everyone else, come on, it is right here, sin, right here. That is a problem. Jesus, however, when he tells us to sin no more, that's not a sin no more, keep it together in your own shoe. No, it's a sin no more by the power of my Spirit. And here's what Jesus has done to help us with sin. Number one, he has forgiven us of our sins.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a beautiful thing, everyone, to be forgiven of your sins.
Yeah.
I don't know what type of sinner you were. Some of y'all might have been sanitized sinners. You just, stole lollipops. Kick the cat, if that's the type of sinner you were. That was not the type of sinner I was. I mean, I didn't want to go into it because I've been forgiven, right? But I was not a sanitized sinner. And so to know that I know that I know that Jesus has forgiven me, that he says there is no shame, there is no condemnation, there's nothing that you have done in accordance with Romans 8 that can separate you from this love of God is a wonderful truth, everyone. I can go and sin no more because I've been forgiven. And it's not even just forgiveness, but Jesus also comes and he takes away our sin. So I'm forgiven and then it's taken away. It says as far as the east is from the west, that's how far he has removed our transgressions from us. Come on. As far as east is from the west. You know that is infinitely far. That means that God has brought a separation. And I put my faith in Jesus Christ. He's given me a new identity in him. No longer a sinner, but forever a son. Separates our sin. Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. He's taking it away. So he forgives us and takes it away. And then, this is the beautiful thing. This is part of the walking thing. This is part of we've had the miracle. Okay? The miracle often is that forgiveness. The miracle is often the release that we get when it's taken away. It's like a burden is taken off your shoulder. So those are the miracle moments. Now, here's how we walk it out. He says, now, let me help you. Sin still lies at the door and it's crouching to overtake you. And even though I've given you a new nature, your old man, this flesh, as long as you're on the planet, this flesh will try to consume you. So here's what I'm doing for you, church. Here's what I'm doing for you, sons and daughters. I'm giving you my Spirit and my grace to overcome sin.
Amen.
And you truly can go and sin no more. Romans, let me get there. And Romans 5 and 20. It says, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound.
Amen.
Grace is the divine empowerment of the Holy Spirit. It's Jesus living inside of you and working through you. Can you think about that? Think about every single place in your life where sin abounded. But now grace much more abounds. All those places and instances where maybe it would have been a trigger in the past or a slippery slope into temptation or something that was overwhelming or would have brought you worry and anxiety. But now, in all those places where sin grace awaits to overtake those places for the glory of God.
Amen.
We close with this right here. In 2 Corinthians 12 and 9, the Apostle Paul is sharing with us his struggle. I want you to think about this practically. Paul is saying, I'm an apostle to nations. I have traveled and planted churches. I've raised up disciples for the kingdom of God. I have written and am writing by the inspiration of the Spirit scripture that will be immortalized as the Word of God. But I have yet and still this thorn in my flesh. We don't know what this thorn in the flesh was. We don't know. Some theologians suggest that maybe it was his eyesight. He had bad eyes. You know, in one letter he says, I've written with large letters. And we try to attach onto that. He wrote real big because he couldn't see. We don't know. So I mean, let's just pretend for a second. Paul has got bad eyesight. Something degenerate is happening with his eyes. You know, I'll call him something. We don't know. I can't see God. I've been praying and asking him. I'm losing my eyesight. Lord, would you please come and fix this? This is a thorn in my flesh. I could serve you so much better. I could preach so much better. I could win so many more. I might be able to handle things so much better if you would just bring healing to my eyes. Didn't happen. Because the Lord says that. Paul says this, I prayed three times, again and again and again, asking you to make a difference in this situation. And if it was his eyesight, it probably didn't help that he got stoned to death. And had some head injuries. We don't know. But this is how the Lord responded to him. 2 Corinthians 12 and 9 says, and he sent unto me, Paul, whatever the problem is, my grace is sufficient for thee. Not giving you a magical moment, but I'm giving you Jesus who imparts to you grace, and that will be sufficient. Amen. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. What? This is another one of those. Your thoughts higher than my God. Your strength is perfected in my weakness. By humbly confessing and yielding to you, you somehow use my limitation for your glory. Paul goes on to say, most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities of body and soul, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Jesus, our source for healing and power. I want to pray for us this morning before we depart. And if you can identify with anything that's been shared today, I just want to ask you to stand. Sometimes it's hard, let me talk about me again, sometimes it's been hard for me as a leader, as a believer, as a teacher, even in occupational capacities, you know, I'm supposed to be the person that has the answers, right? Something's wrong in the school, who do you talk to? The principal. So it's been a challenge for me to embrace the place of limitation and weakness. What God's been teaching me over the last 3 months is that when you embrace that limitation and weakness, that actually is the yes for grace to come. So, Father, I pray right now for your sons and daughters here this morning. Lord, that we would embrace the place of limitation. God, that we would embrace it with Jesus at the helm and with his voice very clearly in our ears asking us, do you want to be made well? Lord, our answer, even in this prayer, is yes, Lord, we do. We don't offer any excuses. We don't talk back, but we just say, yes, we do. And Lord, regardless of how you want to bring resolution to our lives, we see the fact that you are the one that makes us whole. That you give us these moments of miraculous prayer. For that, we say thank you and do it again, God. But we also are seeing that you're the one that walks with us through fire. You're the one that gives us grace for every moment of the day, every sphere and place that sin has abounded. But we ask now that your grace would abound in and through us. Father, I pray that every lie of the enemy that's been spoken in our ears would be silent, and that we would hear you reiterating and verifying that we have been made whole by your Spirit. And out of that confidence and truth, that we would walk into this week and all the days beyond. beyond, knowing that we know that we know that Jesus, you are our source of healing and power. God, as you do this in us, we pray that you would take the little bit we have to offer you, like fishes and loaves, and that you would multiply it, bless it and multiply it, and feed the multitude that you need to do so from our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.